William Howard Taft was an American jurist and statesman who served as both the 27th President of the United States and later the 10th Chief Justice of the United States. A leader during the Progressive Era, Taft and his conservative allies took control of the Republican Party away from Theodore Roosevelt and the liberals. He is the only person to have presided over both the executive and judicial branches of the United States federal government. Before becoming president, Taft served as Solicitor General of the United States and as a judge on the United States Court of Appeals for the Sixth Circuit. In 1900, President William McKinley appointed Taft Governor General of the Philippines. In 1904, President Theodore Roosevelt appointed Taft Secretary of War in an effort to groom Taft, then his close political ally, into his hand-picked presidential successor. Taft assumed a prominent role in problem-solving, assuming on some occasions the role of acting Secretary of State, while declining repeated offers from Roosevelt to serve on the Supreme Court. Riding a wave of popular support for fellow Republican Roosevelt, Taft won an easy victory in his 1908 bid for the presidency. In his only term, Taft's domestic agenda emphasized trust-busting, civil service reform, strengthening the Interstate Commerce Commission, improving the performance of the Postal Service, and passage of the 16th Amendment, creating a federal income tax. Abroad, Taft sought to further the economic development of nations in Latin America and Asia through dollar diplomacy, and showed decisiveness and restraint in response to revolution in Mexico. The task-oriented Taft was oblivious to the political ramifications of his decisions, often alienated his own key constituencies, and was overwhelmingly defeated in his bid for a second term in the presidential election of 1912. After leaving office, Taft spent his time in academia, arbitration, and the pursuit of world peace through his self-founded League to Enforce Peace. In 1921, President Warren G. Harding appointed Taft Chief Justice of the United States. He emphasized conservative policies and efficient management. Today, Taft is generally listed near the middle in historians' rankings of U.S. presidents. Early life and education. William Howard Taft was born September 15, 1857, in Cincinnati, Ohio, the son of Alfonso Taft and his second wife, Louise Torrey. The Taft family was not wealthy, living in a modest home in the suburb of Mount Auburn. Alfonso had failed in a bid for Congress in 1856, and would be unsuccessful in two tries for the Republican gubernatorial nomination in 1875 and 1879. He would have more luck in appointed office, serving as a judge, ambassador and as war secretary and attorney general under Grant. William Howard Taft's paternal grandfather, Peter Rawson Taft, had been a judge in Vermont. Alfonso emigrated west, eventually to Ohio, and when his first wife, Eliza Phelps, died in 1852, married Louise a year and a half later, on December 26, 1853. Eliza had been from the Taft hometown of Townshend, Vermont, and Alfonso Taft looked east again for his second spouse. Louise Torrey lived in Millbury, Massachusetts, and Alfonso met her on a visit there. William Howard Taft was the eldest of three children, all sons, born to Louise and Alfonso. William had two surviving older half-brothers. William Taft was not seen as brilliant as a child, but was a hard worker. The demanding parents pushed the five boys towards success, tolerating nothing less. He attended Woodward High School in Cincinnati, a public school and highly competitive, where he excelled. His success was not enough to fully satisfy his parents, who felt he had a tendency towards laziness. Like others in his family, he attended Yale College in New Haven, Connecticut. At Yale, which he entered in 1874, the heavyset, jovial Taft was popular, to the disquiet of his father, who thought popularity unlikely to be consistent with achievement. One classmate described him succeeding through hard work rather than being the smartest, but he remembered Taft for sterling integrity. He was a member of the Linonian Society, a literary and debating society, Skull and Bones, the secret society co-founded by his father in 1832, and the beta chapter of the Psi Upsilon fraternity. He was given the nickname Big Lub because of his size, but his college friends knew him by the nickname Old Bill. While Taft's weight sometimes made him the target of attempts at humor, he usually took them with grace and himself made self-deprecating jokes. Despite his size, he was a good dancer and a better-than-average athlete who enjoyed golf, tennis and horseback riding. Using his size to advantage, Taft was Yale's intramural heavyweight wrestling champion. In 1878, Taft graduated, ranking second in his class out of 121. According to Taft biographer Jonathan Lurie, Taft's parents were disappointed, but young Taft probably thought it was just fine. Alfonso Taft had proclaimed of his son William that law is his destiny and he should be in it. Obediently, the younger Taft made plans to attend law school. Alfonso had attended Yale Law School, but William chose to attend Cincinnati Law School. At that time, when many lawyers had not attended law school, the choice of school did not carry the importance it later would, and William Taft's life still revolved around the city of his birth. He graduated with a Bachelor of Laws in 1880. While in law school, he worked on the Cincinnati Commercial newspaper, edited by Murat Halstead. Taft was assigned to cover the local courts, and also spent time reading law in his father's office. Both activities gave him practical knowledge of the law that was taught in no class. Shortly before graduating from law school, Taft went to the state capital of Columbus to take the bar examination and easily passed. Rising government. Ohio lawyer and judge. After admission to the Ohio bar, Taft devoted himself to his job at the Commercial full-time. Halstead was willing to take him on permanently at an increase in salary if he would give up the law, but Taft declined. In October 1880, Taft was appointed assistant prosecutor for Hamilton County, and took office the following January. Taft later ascribed this first step on a public career that would last most of the rest of his life to having become friends with his predecessor, who then was elected prosecutor and appointed Taft as assistant. Taft served for a year as assistant prosecutor, trying his share of routine cases. Taft resigned in January 1882 after President Chester A. Arthur appointed him collector of internal revenue for the first district, an area centered on Cincinnati. This was a prestigious job with much opportunity for patronage appointments, and had once been held by William Henry Harrison, later President of the United States. Taft quickly accepted. In a 1908 interview, he ascribed his advancement to the influence of his father and to the fact that, like any well-trained Ohio man, I always had my plate the right side up when offices were falling. Once in office, he refused to dismiss competent employees who were politically out of favor, and resigned effective in March 1883, writing to Arthur that he wished to begin private practice in Cincinnati, forming a partnership with Major Harlan Page Lloyd, an associate of his father's. Taft tried many routine cases in the following years. Only one, a failed defense of a newspaper in a libel action, attracted much notice. In 1884, Taft campaigned for the Republican candidate for president, Maine Senator James G. Blaine, who lost to New York Governor Grover Cleveland. In October, a month before the presidential election, Taft had been made chief supervisor of the local elections held that month. As in most Cincinnati elections of the time, there were a large number of frauds, which Taft, despite her appointing 60 special deputies, was unable to prevent. There was widespread violence, and Taft testified before an investigation congressional committee that he had no knowledge of any problems until late in the day. It is not clear when Taft met Helen Herron, but it was no later than 1880. When she mentioned in her diary receiving an invitation to a party from him, By 1884, they were meeting regularly, and in 1885, after an initial rejection, she agreed to marry him. The wedding took place at the Heron home on June 19, 1886. William Taft remained devoted to his wife throughout their almost 44 years of marriage. Nellie Taft pushed her husband much as his parents had, and could be very frank with her criticisms. The couple had three children, of which the eldest, Robert, became a U.S. Senator. In 1887, Taft, then aged 29, was appointed to a vacant seat on the Superior Court of Cincinnati by Governor Joseph B. Foraker. Although the two men had clashed repeatedly as attorneys, Foraker had received positive reviews of Taft's courtroom performance from Judge Judson Harmon, who was resigning. The appointment was good for just over a year, after which Taft would have to face the voters to gain a term in his own right, and in April 1888, he won the first of three elections he faced in his lifetime, the other two being for the presidency. Some two dozen of Taft's opinions as a state judge survive, the most significant being Moores and Co. v. Bricklayers Union No. 1, if only because it was used against him when he ran for president in 1908. The case involved bricklayers who refused to work for any firm that dealt with a company called Parker Brothers, with which they were in dispute. Taft ruled that the union's action amounted to a secondary boycott, which was illegal. In another case, Cincinnati Bell Foundry Co. v. Dodds, a complaint by a company against a former foreman, alleging he had taken trade secrets to a competitor. Taft entered an injunction in favor of the plaintiff. The judge reasoned that as no similar bells had been made by others during the past 20 years, the process was likely secret and not well known as alleged by Dodds. Solicitor General and federal judge in 1890, President Benjamin Harrison appointed him Solicitor General of the United States, at age 32. He was the youngest ever Solicitor General. Taft then began serving on the newly created United States Court of Appeals for the Sixth Circuit in 1891. He was confirmed by the Senate on March 17, 1892, and received his commission that same day. In about 1893, Taft decided in favor of the processing aluminum patents belonging to the Pittsburgh Reduction Company, now known as ALCA, along with his judgeship. Between 1896 and 1900, Taft also served as the first dean and a professor of constitutional law at the University of Cincinnati. Philippine years in 1900. President William McKinley appointed Taft chairman of a commission to organize a civilian government in the Philippines, which had been ceded to the United States by Spain following the Spanish-American War and the 1898 Treaty of Paris. Although Taft had been opposed to the annexation of the islands, and had told McKinley his real ambition was to become a justice of the Supreme Court of the United States, he reluctantly accepted the appointment. From 1901 to 1904, Taft served as the first civilian governor-general of the Philippines, a position in which he was very popular with both Americans and Filipinos. In 1902, Taft visited Rome to negotiate with Pope Leo XIII for the purchase of Philippine lands owned by the Roman Catholic Church. Taft then persuaded Congress to appropriate more than $7 million to purchase these lands, which he sold to Filipinos on easy terms. In 1903, President Theodore Roosevelt offered Taft the seat on the Supreme Court to which he had for so long aspired, but he reluctantly declined since he viewed the Filipinos as not yet being capable of governing themselves and because of his popularity among them. This dedication to the task at hand was the source of much frustration of his political colleagues. According to biographer Anderson, contrary to the belief of Roosevelt and other allies, Taft's role as governor-general in the Philippines did not serve to equip him with the political skills essential for the White House. Secretary of War in 1904, Roosevelt appointed Taft as Secretary of War. This appointment allowed Taft to remain involved in the Philippines, and Roosevelt also assured Taft he would support his later appointment to the court. While Taft agreed to support Roosevelt in the presidential election of 1904, Roosevelt made the basic policy decisions regarding military affairs, using Taft as a well-traveled spokesman who campaigned for Roosevelt's re-election in 1904. Of Taft's appointment, Roosevelt said, "If only there were three of you, I could appoint one of you to the court, one to the War Department and one to the Philippines." Taft met with the Emperor of Japan, who alerted him of the probability of war with Russia. In 1905, Taft met with Japanese Prime Minister Katsura Taro. At that meeting, the two signed a secret diplomatic memorandum now called the Taft-Katsura Agreement. Contrary to rumor, the memorandum did not establish any new policies but instead repeated the public positions of both nations. On September 29, 1906, Secretary Taft initiated the second occupation of Cuba when he established the Provisional Government of Cuba under the terms of the Cuban-American Treaty of Relations of 1903, declaring himself Provisional Governor of Cuba. The U.S. sent troops to restore order in Cuba during the revolt led by General Enrique Loynas del Castillo, and Taft temporarily became the civil governor of Cuba, personally negotiating with Castillo for a peaceful end to the revolt. On October 13, Taft was succeeded as provisional governor by Charles Edward Magoon. On October 23, President Roosevelt issued Executive Order 518, ratifying the order and ordering Magoon to report to Taft through the Bureau of Insular Affairs. Also in that year, Roosevelt made his third offer to Taft of a position on the court, which he again declined out of a sense of duty to resolve pending issues in the Philippines. Had it been for the Chief Justice seat, a different result may well have ensued. Taft indicated to Roosevelt he wanted to be Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, not President. But there was no vacancy and Roosevelt had other plans. In 1907 he began touting Taft as the best choice for the presidential nomination by the party. Taft's wife was determined to gain the White House and pressured him not to accept a court appointment. Other family members also strongly favored the presidency for him. He gave Taft more responsibilities along with the Philippines and the Panama Canal. For a while, Taft was acting Secretary of State. When Roosevelt was away, Taft was, in effect, the acting president. While serving as the war secretary, Taft generally concentrated on major developments, including the Philippines and the Panama Canal, to the detriment of departmental housekeeping problems, including factionalism within the department, of which Roosevelt was aware. In 1903, the Habun-Alvarilla Treaty granted the U.S. construction rights for the Panama Canal, which Roosevelt delegated to the War Department, and Taft thereby supervised the beginning of construction on the canal. Taft promoted a reduction in the tariffs on sugar and tobacco in the Philippines, a position with which Roosevelt disagreed. Taft offered to resign, but this was refused by Roosevelt. Taft also had a disagreement with Roosevelt over the latter's conclusion of an executive agreement with the Dominican Republic, in lieu of what Taft thought should have been a treaty, requiring ratification by the Senate. Roosevelt dismissed the complaint as trifling, and Taft, in his usual style, let it go. Presidential election of 1908. Theodore Roosevelt had become president after William McKinley was assassinated in 1901. After getting elected president in his own right in 1904, on election night on the lawn of the White House, Roosevelt publicly declared he would not run for re-election in 1908, a decision that he immediately regretted. But he felt bound by his word. Taft was the logical successor, but he was initially reluctant to run, as he had been earlier. As a member of Roosevelt's cabinet, he had declared that his future ambition was to serve on the Supreme Court, not the White House. Taft's efforts in stumping for the party in the 1906 midterm elections made him aware of his deficiencies as an effective campaigner. Mrs. Taft even commented during this time, "Never did he cease to regard a Supreme Court appointment as more desirable than the presidency." But Taft conceded, with his extensive involvement as the most prominent member of the cabinet, that he was the most available man. Thus he agreed that were he to be nominated for president, he would put his personal convictions aside and run a vigorous campaign. At the time, Roosevelt was convinced that Taft was a genuine progressive and helped push through the nomination of his Secretary of War onto the Republican ticket on the first ballot at the party convention. His opponent in the general election was William Jennings Bryan, who had already run for president twice before, in 1896 and in 1900 against William McKinley. During the campaign, Taft undercut Bryan's liberal support by accepting some of his reformist ideas, and Roosevelt's progressive policies blurred the distinctions between the parties. Bryan, on the other hand, ran an aggressive campaign against the nation's business elite. The Democrats referred to Taft's nomination and potential election, predetermined by the powerful Roosevelt, as a possible forced succession to the presidency. It did not take long for Taft's markedly different style and lack of political acumen to emerge. Joseph B. Foraker of Ohio, seeking Taft's support in his senatorial re-election, made an appearance with Taft, creating the impression Taft was allied with the big business trusts, and when Taft failed to follow the Hearst papers in denouncing Foraker's association with them, Roosevelt became incensed. Taft also showed his political ineptness by choosing Frank Hitchcock to be chairman of the Republican Party. Hitchcock was quick to bring in men closely allied with big business, which further alienated the progressive wing of the party. Despite the difference in styles, Taft had demonstrated for the most part that the substance of his policies echoed those of Roosevelt. In the end, Taft won by a comfortable electoral margin, giving Bryan his worst loss in three presidential campaigns. Taft defeated Bryan by 159 electoral votes, however, he garnered just 51% of the popular vote. Mrs.